Welcome, welcome, welcome to another. It's Thursday. It's hot here in Southern California. On the show today for the whole hour on KHTS, award-winning KHTS, you can listen on live if you're driving and you're on your way home and you think the show's going to be, well, I know it's going to be interesting. You know why? Because maybe, just maybe, I have the smartest man in America on the show today. My ex-co-host, when we were on KKZ, KVTA out of Ventura, California, we did a show together for a number of years. We're going to talk about technology. We're going to talk about alternative currency, cryptocurrency. So we'll save that for the second segment. So Bill Frank, I nicknamed you Billy the Brain. You graduated with honors from Duke University, next to the University of Oregon, probably one of the most prestigious schools in the United States. Welcome. How are you, pal?
I'm doing great, Coach. And yeah, right after University of Oregon, that's where Duke ranks in the whole pantheon of universities.
So, so honored to have you. I consider you one of my dear friends. I call you every week just to listen to your voice and share and ask you dumb questions about life and business, and you always have a great response. So I'm so glad to have you on our show. We call it the Edge Radio Show. We've been doing it for a number of years. My partner on the show, Scott Harries, is at a big fancy meeting today in Newport Beach, so he will not be joining us. But I have my ex-partner, Mr. Bill Frank. So, Billy, let's get right into it. I had a conversation with you Monday of this week that just shook me to the core. I'm not kidding you. I've been thinking about that conversation all week. I mentioned it to my wife, to my friends, to my daughters. The iPhone that you and I carry, it, to me, after my conversation with you, I was scared, I was angry, I was mad, I was upset. I didn't realize that Big Brother, I didn't realize I was being watched, Bill. I'm being watched. Well, and when you told me that my eye movements were being watched, I said, holy schmoly. So let's talk a little bit about technology, and more specifically, I think, how dangerous this technology is in our phones. I don't like it one bit, and I'm on my phone all day long. Yeah. What do you got to say?
All right, well, let's talk about it. Let's talk about it, because this really, it needs to go back and get a little background on this. We've been through perhaps the most interesting 3 weeks of product announcements in the history of technology. I mean, 3 weeks ago, we had Google's I.O. conference, followed by Facebook's F8 conference. Apple had their Worldwide Developer Conference, and Samsung had its big announcement. And what sparked our conversation on Monday, Coach, was I was telling you what Samsung announced at their big meeting. They announced a 50-gigapixel camera in their phones. Now, to me, that's just mind-boggling how much information that a 50-gigapixel camera is actually capturing. And that's when you and I got off onto this discussion about what sort of information are they capturing. Well, a 50-gigapixel camera can get minute detail from you. And I guess what people didn't realize, after I talked to you, I realized that people didn't understand. There are two cameras on almost every phone. There's the camera that you take pictures with, and then there's the forward-facing camera, the one that looks back at you. So that if you are doing a video conference or a Zoom call, it's that forward-looking camera that's important, because that's the one that's focused on you. And that camera is the camera that is capturing all of the information. And this is where you and I got off on this long discussion. Clearly, a 50-gigapixel camera can get minute details. It can actually see the pores in your skin. But some of the things that they might be tracking with that 50-gigapixel camera, your eyes. They know not only what color your eyes are, but how far apart they're set. And what's interesting to you, they watch the movement of your eyes. They notice the 50-gigapixel camera can notice things like if your pupils are dilating or shrinking. And obviously, psychologists know that if your pupils are dilating, you're interested in something. Furthermore, a 50-gigapixel camera can watch your eye movements from left to right. It can actually track what you're looking at on the screen of your phone, whether it's an iPhone or a Samsung or Xiaomi or whatever brand of phone you happen to have. They all do the same thing, essentially. So So it's tracking your eye movements. Imagine that if you're looking on Amazon, for example, and you're just kind of scrolling, you might be looking for, I don't know, you might be looking for a chopper of some kind for the kitchen, and you're scrolling through the list, and the camera, the forward-facing camera, is tracking your eye movements. It knows when you are interested in something. It tells that your eyes tell the camera, wait, his pupils are dilating. That means he's interested in this. He stopped on this particular model. He must be interested in this model more than some of the other models that he's looked at. And they're gathering all kinds of information just from your eye movements. Now, that's not all. That's just the camera portion of these phones. Apple, at their Worldwide Developer Conference, actually showcased one of their neat new features for elderly people. It's a fall detector. It tells the phone can tell when you've tripped and fallen. It has numerous gyros inside of the phone, and it will tell when you're tumbling or when you're falling. And it will then send a signal. It will first ask you and then send the signal to police or fire to come and get you if you have fallen and you're incapacitated, which is kind of a cool feature. But what they don't tell you is that same set of gyros is also tracking the way that you walk. It knows how far you're stepping, what a normal step is for you. It's tracking your gait. It knows if you're walking fast. It knows if you're walking slow. It knows if you're just kind of ambling along. It can also tell when there's a change in the way that you walk. So over time, the gyros are collecting all the information about the way that you walk, and it notices, well, wait a minute, Bill's walking a little bit funny, a little bit slower. He's favoring his left foot more than he has in the past. That might be the beginning of something in a change in his medical history. And it notices those kinds of things. So imagine
this is
now.
Crazy. Bill, this is so crazy. I got a million questions. Listen to Bill Frank, maybe the smartest person in America and the dumbest person in America is going to be asking him the question. It's called The Edge Radio Show. Patty's running the show as he's been doing it for years, doing a great job. Patty, so you're a young man. Some of these things that Bill Frank, Billy the Brain is bringing. Are you aware of any of these things, Bill? Patty?
Yeah, I've been aware of some of these, like the technological advancements of how, like, you know, the with the cameras. Like, that's not. It's never been a shock to me. I've known and heard about that many a time.
So I'm the last guy in America to know that it's charting my eye movements. And when my eyes get dilated or I walk, are you kidding me, Bill Frank? So let me just ask this first question. Let me figure out how I want to pose it. So going to the political question, we don't do politics on this show, but is this going to affect or is it affecting how we vote? Are they charting our behavior? Our political behavior too?
Well, that's a loaded question. So let's again take a look at the bigger picture. Why are these companies doing this? Why would Google
sell
or Amazon
stuff. They want to sell us
exactly.
Stuff.
This is all part of an advertising play. I mean, let's face it. Google and Facebook, their main business is selling advertising. So they are taking your biometric information, processing it, and selling it to advertisers. As I always tell my grandchildren, when you get a product for free, like you get Facebook or like you get Google search, when you get a product for free, you are the product. They're selling your data. That's what's important. So Facebook and Google are taking this information. They're bundling it. They're aggregating it with other people's information, and then they're selling it to advertisers. That's the way that it works. So to answer your question about politics, clearly they can tell as you are scrolling through your Facebook feed and you see something in the Facebook feed about President Biden and you stop and your eyes dilate, they know that you have an interest in Biden. Or if you're scrolling through your feed and you see something about President Trump and your eyes dilate, they know that you have an interest in Trump. They take that information, they aggregate it with other people who are interested in Trump, and they sell it to the Trump campaign or to the Biden campaign so that they can put political ads in front of you. That's how it works.
So they don't know what political party I am, but just what you said, based on what I'm researching or what emotions I show, they're collecting that data. Wow.
Right.
Wow.
So Google is a search engine.
Go ahead.
I was just going to say Google is a search engine, knows your whole history of searches. So if you go online and you are looking for information about cryptocurrencies, for example, and then all of a sudden you run across a libertarian web page that has information about cryptocurrencies, all of a sudden Google knows that information and they can tell that you have political leanings towards libertarianism because you stopped on that web page as you were doing the research for your cryptocurrency information. And so, yes, they can infer a lot of things from the data that you give them, your search history, your flow and through Facebook's feed, and all of that is providing constant feedback and constant information.
All right. I want to just do a little reset here. You're listening to maybe the smartest man in America. His name is Bill Frank, Billy the Brain. You have a website too, don't you, Billy? What's your website?
Yeah, it's called brainstorming.online.com, brainstorming.online.com.
And if you want to listen to some of his great 16,000 interviews, I can't think of anybody in America that does better interviewing. So you're listening to KHTS, The Edge Radio Show. You can listen. We have the best radio app in the United States. I'm not kidding when I say that. The owners of this station have invested so much money to bring technology to you. Just go to the App Store and download AM 1220 or KHTS 1220 AM, and you will be able to take the show and KHTS with you everywhere. Obviously, you can listen on hometownstation.com. So my question, or two questions, is are we really a free society with all of this information? The second question number two, is the small business owner, the entrepreneur that needs data, they can't afford to buy this data. So only the big boys have the data. And my concern is, what's going to happen if only the largest and the most well-financed companies are running this country? Two questions. Are we a free country with all of this? And are we going to be able to compete with the big boys?
Well, to answer the first question about being a free country, yes, we are still a free country, but we have to be aware of the data that's being collected on us. And here's how we are free. In China, when President Xi took power, one of the first things he did was to go and visit a large Chinese company called Tencent. Now, for people who are not familiar with it, Tencent is a lot bigger than Amazon. It's a lot bigger than any of the companies that we have here. But they collect data, just like all of Amazon, Facebook, and the rest of them. And he went to them and said, wow, this is wonderful to see how you're moving the company forward, collecting all this data. And, oh, by the way, wouldn't this data be wonderful for the Chinese Communist Party to have? And so he started making overtures to Tencent to get their data. Here in the United States, we have bits and pieces of that. You'll remember back in when there was the San Bernardino shooting, and they realized that the shooter had an iPhone, and the feds went to Apple and said, give us the data from the iPhone, unlock it so we can do that. Apple steadfastly said no. But there have been other examples with Facebook and Google when there have been terrorist activities where they've gone to both Facebook and Google, and they've asked for information, and they've turned them over. And then there are times.
So Apple sells the data, but they won't give the feds information on criminals that are killing people.
Yeah, that is correct. Do you remember that? It's 2015. And
I remember.
There was a San Bernardino shooting. And they went to Apple. They went to Apple and said, give us the information. Apple said no. They took a hard line. And yes, it was very controversial, but Apple said no. They eventually got the information. You know, America has some of the world's best hackers. I'm sure they found a backdoor into it. They eventually, the feds eventually got the information, but Apple didn't provide it. Now, fast forward to just this year, it's becoming obvious that both Apple and Facebook were asked for information on reporters during the Trump presidency, reporters that were pursuing stories that were unfavorable to the president. And they asked for the information, and Apple and Facebook gave them the information, not knowing what it was for. And eventually it became clear, and it was revealed just recently, that the feds were using that information against reporters that were reporting stories that were unfavorable to the president. So are we a free country? Yes, we are. Do we have to be very concerned about the amount of data that's out there and who gets it and how they get access to it? Most certainly we do, because this is just the tip of the iceberg, Coach. I mean, to share with you some other facts that will probably shake you to your boots. Think about this. Your Alexa, your Siri, those are devices that are always on, always listening, because they're listening for the name Alexa or Siri to trigger them. But they're listening to all of those conversations, and that data is being collected. Facebook is constant, and Instagram are constantly gathering data. Whether you are using Facebook on your phone or not, it's still gathering data as you go. They're devices that are always called always on, meaning that they're capturing all that information. What they're doing with that data, we don't know. But
Thanks for making me sad and make me feel like I don't even matter anymore. That's how I feel, really.
You shouldn't be trivialized, because you've signed away all your rights to this. Every time a new Facebook version comes out and they ask you to read those terms and conditions, and if you're like me and most people in America, you just blow through that and you hit the okay button. But if you were to ever stop and look at those terms and conditions, it tells you what they're collecting and what they'll use it for. So it's buried in legalese, and they know that people don't read legalese and that most people will just sign away the rights. But if push ever came to shove, they could come back to you, Coach, and say, Coach, you agreed to our terms and conditions. What are you complaining about? You should know better. You should have read those terms and conditions. And they knew full well that you weren't going to read all 130 pages of it, but that's what they do.
I know. I mean, I agree to everything. Everybody's got my social security number and blah, blah, blah. But, you know, we're going to go to break here in a second. Our block B, we're going to get into cryptocurrency, which is another huge, huge part of how technology is playing into our life and how it might be very, very disruptive and very harmful. I'm just going to plant that little teaser because, in my opinion, cryptocurrency could be very, very serious and very disruptive and cause a lot of people a lot of harm. But we'll save that for the next block. So to finish up on this block, talking to Bill Frank on award-winning KHTS The Edge radio show. Bill, you were just nominated by a board of directors to be our tech reporter, so we're going to have you back on often because, look, obviously I've turned out to be a dummy. I don't know about this stuff, and even if I know about it, Bill, what the hell can I do about it? There's not a darn thing I can do about it.
Well, there's always the option of walking away from the technology. Remember, you make a choice every day. You don't have to use the iPhone. You can go back to a flip phone if you want to do that and get away from the smartphone altogether. But if we want to participate in the modern society, then we make sacrifices. We make trade-offs. And part of that trade-off is trading off a little bit of our information for the opportunity to use Google search or to see pictures of our family on Facebook and so forth. Now, there's a solution to this. Interestingly enough, it ties into our second segment, so I guess I'm teasing it in a way. But the answer to all of this is called blockchain technology, and it's the blockchain technology that's the foundation of cryptocurrencies, whether it's Bitcoin or Ethereum or Dogecoin or any of the other digital currencies that are out there. it's the blockchain that's going to be the savior to that, because blockchain allows you to maintain your anonymity, and more importantly, it allows you to control what information people get. So that's the solution.
All right, we've got to go to break. We're going to come back. We're going to get into more technology. Our technology reporter, Bill Frank, on the Edge Radio Show, maybe, just maybe, the smartest guy in America. Look, if you're listening to his voice and listening to our show, you feel it and you know it too. We're going to come right back, and we're going to get into cryptocurrency on the Edge Radio Show. Be right back, ladies and gentlemen.
At the Burrito Factory, their motto has always been to serve quality food with fast, friendly service. But did I mention the taste? When it comes to authentic taste and huge mouth-watering burritos, the Burrito Factory is second to none. Whether it's lunch, dinner, or a catered event, Burrito Factory has the taste of Mexico to satisfy your craving. Burrito Factory on Soledad Canyon Road next to Chi Chi's Pizza in Canyon Country. Stop in or call ahead, 288-0222.
Loss of hearing can affect the quality of life. Santa Clarita Hearing Center can help. They specialize in both preventative hearing loss and corrective measures, including diagnostic tests, new technology hearing aids, cochlear implants, hearing protection, and tinnitus treatment. They can adjust your current hearing aids or fit you for new ones. Santa Clarita Hearing Center also offers sleep molds, swim molds, and musician monitors. Book an appointment today. Log on to SantaClaritaHearingCenter.com, located on McBean Parkway next to the hospital. That's SantaClaritaHearingCenter.com.
When you look at your child, you see so much. A creative spirit that surprises you every day. A little leader growing to discover who they are, what they love, and how they can make the world better. At SCVI, we see those same amazing things. Our tuition-free TK through 12 charter school provides boundless opportunities to think critically and imagine freely, with a learning program customized just for your child. Today, that means empowering your child to bring strengths and passions to the distance learning environment. Our approach keeps your child and family in step while online, inspiring your learner to keep growing without missing a beat. At SCVI, your child will find even more ways to grow with projects and activities in STEAM, robotics, theater, music, and sports. With the only international baccalaureate program in Santa Clarita, SCVI produces graduates who excel at top universities and in life. For enrollment information or to learn more about our distance learning program, visit iLeadSantaClarita.org. iLead Schools. Free to think, inspired to lead.
I listen to it all day, every day.
Hometown, your hometown station.
I'm back. Let's go. Cut the music. Let's get into it. So, Patty's running the show, as he has been for a number of years. It's called The Edge Radio Show, an award-winning KHTS 98.1 FM, 1220 AM. You can listen on hometownstation.com or the best radio app in America. I'm not kidding. Just go to the App Store and download KHTS 1220 AM, and you can take KHTS everywhere with you. So on The Edge Radio Show, we bring on guests that try to give you an edge in life. And what do I mean by that? What I mean is, if you have an edge in life, you have an advantage. And if you have an advantage, maybe you're a little bit smarter, maybe you're a little bit more informed, maybe you're a little bit more educated. And that's why I bring on the best guests in America that are experts in their field. And today I have a dear friend who is my ex-co-host. We did a show for a number of years in Ventura on KKZZ and KVTA, Mr. Bill Frank. I nicknamed him Billy the Brain, an honored graduate from Duke University. So, Billy, this segment, we may get a little heated. So if you're driving, you might have to pull over, because I have a big, 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 big concern about cryptocurrency. And my concern, and it was kind of founded last week when cryptocurrency fell 80%. Billions were lost. People who invested their money in cryptocurrency took a nosedive. So let's get started with, I understand alternative currency. Here's my issue. Companies like India, companies like China, and the United States is looking into banning cryptocurrency. currency. Central America, many countries are banning it now. Some of the reasons they're banning it, as you and I both know, are for political reasons, because there's a fear that our current banking system in the United States is going to be so altered that it might have effect on our population. So let's start with this question. Oh, here's another issue. You can now invest your 401k in cryptocurrency. So if you had money in your 401k last week, you took a heck of a nosedive. So I know cryptocurrency and alternative currencies are like a roller coaster. So my concern with that roller coaster issue is, what if you have to cash out? What if you had to cash your 401k out last week? Anyway, I'm throwing a lot of stuff at you, Mr. Bill Frank, Billy the Brain. Let's start the conversation. It's alternative currency. Why do you think it's going to take over the world?
Well, I'm not alone in that. I think we need to unpack this a lot. But let's take a look at just this week in cryptocurrency to give you an idea of where this is headed. Just this week in cryptocurrency, the country of El Salvador said that they will now recognize cryptocurrencies as a legitimate form of legal tender. Jack Dorsey, who many people know is the founder of Twitter, he's also the CEO of the fintech company called Square. He came out very favorably in favor of cryptocurrencies. His company Square accepts and trades in cryptocurrencies. He himself is a big believer and owns tens of thousands, if not millions of dollars worth of cryptocurrencies. Not all
right, time out. I got to call time out. I'm calling time out. I apologize to our listeners. Explain to our listeners what cryptocurrency is. I apologize. Let's start off with what
is
it?
Let's start with the basics. A cryptocurrency is simply a currency that is based on mathematics. Here in the United States, a fiat currency like the U.S. dollar, there's really nothing backing the U.S. dollar, and there hasn't been since Richard Nixon took us off the gold standard in 1972. Now, the only thing that's backing the U.S. dollar is the full faith and governance of the United States government. That's it. That's really all that's behind it. With a cryptocurrency is backed by mathematics. If I have a dollar in Bitcoin and I send that dollar to you, Coach, in Bitcoin, there are people out there called Bitcoin miners that are verifying that transaction using very complex math equations. And once they verify it, they say, all right, Bill has sent one Bitcoin to Coach. That's verified. They get paid in Bitcoin themselves for actually solving the mathematical problem that proves that you and I exchanged one Bitcoin. That's the idea behind it. And personally, I have more faith in mathematics than I do in the United States government, particularly at the rate which they're printing dollars to support things like all of the money that we're spending to help people through the pandemic. But the point is this, that countries like El Salvador, they acknowledge that a cryptocurrency is legal tender. In the country of Turkey, where they have rampant inflation, they accept and acknowledge cryptocurrency as a form of payment and equal to the fiat money they call the lira in Turkey. So the point is that more and more countries are starting to get on side with this. It's a very interesting phenomenon. You mentioned China in this.
Whoa, slow down just a second. Turkey, a central bank, banned the use of cryptocurrencies from the end of April, saying that crypto payments came with significant risks. So that's the latest, that's from USA Today. But what is one coin? Tell me, what is one Bitcoin? What is the value of one Bitcoin?
At this moment, I'd have to look it up. But just recently, it's been as high as $60,000 per Bitcoin. And it's been as low as $3,000 just a few years ago.
So let's say if I wanted to send you $500, how do I send $500?
Okay. You can do it. Bitcoin. You can do it one of two ways. You can use an intermediary like Coinbase to just send me the Bitcoin, or another intermediary would be PayPal or Square. So you can use those companies to send me the Bitcoin, but that's not a true cryptocurrency transaction because we're using Square or PayPal as an intermediary. A true cryptocurrency exchange is peer-to-peer. So I would have a cryptocurrency wallet. You would have a cryptocurrency wallet. I would send you the cryptocurrency because I would send it to an address, like an email address that you gave me. That is the public part of your cryptocurrency wallet. And I could send money or take money from that public part with your permission, and the transfer would happen. So it would go from my wallet to your wallet. Now, each wallet also has the highly secure private key to the wallet. And that's information that only you know or only I know, and nobody else can crack it. The mathematics behind that are such that even the most sophisticated hackers in the world cannot hack my private key or your private key. It is so much more secure than anything that we have today. There's a reason behind it, but let's just suffice it to say that in order for me to hack your private key of your wallet, I would need to get the help of 51% of all of the computers in the world cooperating in my theft of your private key. And there's no way that any human being can get the help of 51% of all of the computers in the world. It's just virtually impossible, which makes cryptocurrencies and the blockchain the most secure form of doing anything on the internet today. Does that make sense?
Wow. Yeah, nothing makes sense to me. Were you listening to the Edge Radio Show? You're listening to maybe, just maybe, one of the smartest men in America talking about technology today. He is our Edge technology reporter. He'll be on many, many times this year. We're going to break things down into hopefully digestible bites. It's the Edge Radio Show on award-winning KHTS. So our block C, we're going to get into AI, artificial intelligence. But let's finish off. How do I want to say this? I understand the importance of alternative currency because I can see the sports industry using it. I can see the marijuana industry using it. You know, the marijuana industry right now is all cash-based because the federal government will not allow Visa, MasterCard. And I could see other industries using this alternative currency. How do you pronounce it, Doge? Is that a brand now of cryptocurrency? Are there brands starting to pop up? Is that what
no,
Doge
there are
Coin is?
Dogecoin. Dogecoin is one
Doge,
of the
Doge,
cryptocurrencies. Yeah. There are over 47 different cryptocurrencies. The three biggest names in cryptocurrency are, however, Bitcoin. Bitcoin has by far the largest market capitalization. And again, to put this in perspective, the market capitalization of Bitcoin is bigger than the market capitalization of the top three U.S. banks combined. So Bitcoin is huge. Ethereum Wow. is the second largest of the cryptocurrencies. And Ethereum, their token that they exchange is called Ether. And Ether has a large market capitalization, but only about one-seventh the size of Bitcoin's market capitalization. And then there's Dogecoin. Dogecoin actually started off as a joke, but has grown into a cryptocurrency. And Dogecoin, some people call it doggy coin, doesn't matter how you pronounce it. It's the fastest growing one, but by far the most volatile and the scariest of the three that we've just talked about. And there are others. Believe me, there are many, many others. Like I said, there are 47 or more in total. So, but those are the big ones to be concerned about. Now, to
so
answer
could there
your,
be five? You know, so 5 years from now, could there be 500 of them or 1,000 of them 5 years from now?
Well, there could be. There could be, but it's unlikely. It's as with any industry, you're going to get your market leaders and everybody else is going to fall by the wayside. Remember back in 1920, a century ago, this country had 50 or 60 different automobile manufacturers. But by the end of the 1950s, we were down to the big three, General Motors, Ford, and Chrysler. So, yes, you could have as many as a couple hundred of these cryptocurrencies running around, but the reality is the market dynamics are going to gravitate towards the ones that have the biggest market capitalization, and the other ones are just going to kind of quietly disappear.
Wow. So,
yeah,
I have 1,000 questions. So I still have to write a check to buy or use a credit card to buy the cryptocurrency, right?
If you use an intermediary like Square or Coinbase or PayPal, yeah, you would. That is true. But remember, those are intermediaries. Those are hybrids, and that's truly not a cryptocurrency. I mean, yes, you are trading in an asset of cryptocurrency, but you are not fully participating in the cryptocurrency market that way. You're doing it through another company. And those other companies have vulnerabilities. They can themselves get hacked. So it is possible that somebody could hack Coinbase or PayPal to get at those cryptocurrencies because they keep them all in one place. You'll remember, this is going back many years now, I think to 2006, when there was one big Bitcoin exchange. It was called Mt. Gox, G-O-X. It was in Japan, and it was the largest single repository of Bitcoin in the world. Well, what happened was that some hackers figured out a way to get into Mt. Gox, and they stole the cryptocurrency that was there. And that's because the cryptocurrencies weren't distributed to all of the computers in the internet. They were in one central place at Mt. Gox, and that point of vulnerability allowed the hackers to go and steal the Bitcoin. And to this day, they have never recaptured all of the Bitcoins that were stolen from Mt. Gox. So when you use a centralized service, then you run that risk.
Okay, so I mean, I don't even know what question to ask you, but so I'm on Instagram, and one of our advertisers is radiotalentpro.com. You go to radiotalentpro.com, you'll find out what they do. If you want to be in radio, just go to radiotalent.pro, and they'll put you on radio. But so I'm on Instagram, and I get contacted every day, Bill, by people that are claiming they're experts in Bitcoin and they want it. So there's what, thousands of Bitcoin salesmen? Are they representing these companies? Is that what's going on?
Well, Bitcoin itself is not a company. Bitcoin is a currency. It's a set of mathematical standards.
No, I get that.
The currency.
I get that.
Okay.
Right.
But these guys that are on Instagram contacting you saying that they are cryptocurrency experts, some of them have some expertise, but others of them and most of them are like the Nigerian prince that constantly contacts you by email saying that he's trapped in jail and just needs some of your money to get out of jail and he will reward you handsomely.
Right.
Most of them are scams, in other words, is what I'm trying to say.
The people that are
Bitcoin experts, well, you know, they're few and far between, and chances are they're not going to be sharing their expertise with you because they're going to be using it themselves to kind of corner the market and capture the market.
We've got to take a break, but we'll come back. I'm going to have you back in a couple of weeks, and we'll keep – this is a big discussion that just – I have to learn. I'm listening to you. I'm taking notes. We're going to take a break. Billy and I are going to come back and talk about something I know a little bit about in the technology world, and that's artificial intelligence. And artificial intelligence, ladies and gentlemen, probably is going to change your life forever, certainly change the world. We're going to get into it. And when Billy comes back in a couple of weeks, Bill Frank, we're going to get a whole segment, but we're going to tease you at the end of our show here. We've got to take a break. It's called The Edge Radio Show on award-winning KHTS. You can listen on Hometown Station. We're on every Tuesday and Thursday at noon with the best and smartest people in America. We'll be right back and talking about AI.
This is Bradley from Santa Clarita Grocery, the all-volunteer grocery program serving children, families, and individuals experiencing food insecurities. Since January 2020, Santa Clarita Grocery has distributed 83 tons of fresh groceries to 4,465 families in the SCV. Santa Clarita Grocery is a drive-up, drive-through service with physical distancing in place to continue serving our community. If you are in need or looking for a charity to do the most good for our community, please consider partnering with us by donating to Santa Clarita Grocery, one of the most efficient charities in the Santa Clarita Valley. A full 99 cents out of every dollar goes directly back to the community. Santa Clarita Grocery operates on a 1% overhead and is sustained through private donations. Santa Clarita Grocery is at 21176 Center Point Parkway in the Oasis Furniture parking lot. Please visit our website, santaclaritagrocery.org, or our Facebook at Santa Clarita Grocery to make a difference in our awesome town community. 661-425-7575. Be our guest and experience the difference.
We salute our veterans who sacrifice for our freedom. Every week, we share an inspirational story of a local veteran on our Hometown Heroes page at hometownstation.com. Thanks to our good friends at Eternal Valley.
I'm Richard Nunnally, General Manager of Eternal Valley Memorial Park and Mortuary. We believe taking care of each other is what community is all about. We're proud to bring you the stories of our hometown heroes.
Eternal Valley, life well celebrated.
Visit hometownstation.com, sponsored by Eternal Valley.
Healthcare can be difficult if you're underinsured or have Medi-Cal. Samuel Dixon Family Health Center can help. Services are available on a sliding fee schedule. The mission of the Samuel Dixon Family Health Center is to give the Santa Clarita Valley access to affordable, quality primary care. There are three locations to serve you: Canyon Country, Newhall, and Valverde. Go to sdfhc.org for more information and to find the location most convenient for you.
It's like no other station I've ever listened to. It's great.
Your hometown station.
I'm back. You know, if you listen to the Edge Radio Show every Tuesday and Thursday at noon, you don't have to go to Harvard. You don't have to go to Duke. You don't have to go to the University of Oregon. We do a master class for an hour every Tuesday and Thursday. I get the brightest people. Scott Harries and I get the brightest people in America. And if you've been listening to the show today, I nicknamed him Billy the Brain, Bill Frank. Billy, what's your website again, please, one more time, your website?
The website is brainstormingonline.com.
And some of the greatest interviews I've ever listened to. So AI, artificial intelligence, what the heck is it and why is it going to take over the world?
Well, artificial intelligence is a set of mathematical rules that allows you to do certain things. And it is proving to be very, very capable at many things that it undertakes. And it also has some limitations. But let's talk about its capabilities. For example, artificial intelligence has been programmed to play chess and can beat the grandmasters of chess in any game that it plays. No matter what happens, the artificial intelligence can calculate the different moves at a rate so much faster than a human being, and it comes up with the best, most optimal solution and inevitably wins the game. Another game is the Chinese game of Go, which is much more complex than chess. And people for years thought that artificial intelligence could never master the game of Go. And yet, 2 years ago, artificial intelligence beat the grandmaster of Go in the game and has never actually relinquished that title. I mean, AI is dominant in that field. AI, in more practical terms, can be used for things in the medical profession. You can use AI to diagnose things like cancer. They have run trials at the major cancer institutes around the United States where they pit human diagnosticians versus AI looking at lung cancer x-rays. and they look at these lung cancer x-rays looking for tumors, looking for signs of cancer. And in every case, the AI does a better job than the human at detecting cancer earlier than the human diagnostician, the human doctor, let's just put it that way. And so AI can be used for very many things. It can be used for practical things, but its best uses are when you have a defined set of rules like chess or like Go or like searching for a cancer. What doesn't happen is that AI cannot think for itself, like Hollywood wants us to believe that AI is going to create this killer monster robot like HAL in the year 2001 Space Odyssey, where it's going to take things over. AI cannot do that because it cannot think like a human. It can think within rules, but it will never outthink or outperform a human in things like creativity and just basic moral dilemmas. That's where AI falls short. Does that make sense?
It makes a lot of sense. There's a part of AI that I love. I understand. I'm looking forward to my robot. I've already named him Little Duke. AI flies airplanes. People don't realize who flies airplanes. It's artificial intelligence flying the airplanes. My concern always is, you know, like the other day, my wife is flying home from San Francisco to see our daughter. TSA's weather computer went down, and there was about an hour delay. So all this technology is scary because what if these computers that are flying airplanes get hacked into? What if the surgical can't think of the thing that does that started 10 years ago? And when you come back, we'll talk about the health field, because I think the health field started doing surgeries 10 years ago.
The Da Vinci cataract.
There you go. I mean, cataract. So all of this, I understand. Some of it I really appreciate. I guess my concern is could the manufacturers or some renegade lone wolf programmer program stuff in to this AI stuff that could take out thousands or hundreds of thousands of people? That's just me. But when you look at driverless cars coming, you see some point, where the infrastructure of the United States is way behind other countries. So I could see this being a big economic benefit to the United States if we get the right political people in there. I don't want to get into that. But, you know, we are lagging other countries in AI. I don't get that part. But what do you see, and we only got a couple of minutes left. We've got like 3 minutes left. What do you see coming down in the next couple of years that's going to be very helpful to the American public?
Wow. All right. Well, first, let me say that technology by itself, whether it's AI or driverless cars, that kind of stuff, is benign. It's neither good nor bad. It's how people use it. For the example that I always use is the airplane. You know, the airplane can take your wife to San Francisco to see your granddaughter, but that same airplane can be fitted with bombs, and it can drop bombs and kill people. So it's how the technology is used. Technology is again, being used for a lot of different things. It will make rapid advancements in the medical fields. That's where it's going to make the biggest impact for most Americans most quickly. Google right now has a program that can fold aminos faster than any human can calculate how to do that. And that allows scientists to figure out new medicines, to figure out new ways of treating cancer. It's because of technology like the Google's amino folding that allowed us to get a vaccine for COVID within 12 months. I mean, that was record-breaking time to develop a vaccine. And the only way that that could have been done was through the use of artificial intelligence and computers. Keep in mind that, you know, it took us thousands and tens of thousands of years to get a cure for polio, and we got a COVID cure in less than 12 months. So that's the type of thing in the medical field where you're going to see the most rapid advancements, the biggest benefits to humankind of artificial intelligence. And to answer your question, to put your mind at ease about some evil entity getting into AI and destroying the world, that's wonderful for movies and things that Hollywood wants to take up. But the reality is that most AI has got dozens of people looking at it, people checking and rechecking and rechecking the rechecking of how the code is put together. So the chances of something evil and diabolical getting through are slim. I'm not saying that it couldn't happen, but it's slim. So guys like Elon Musk, who think that AI is going to be the most evil thing on the planet, have probably been watching too many sci-fi movies, in my opinion.
All right, baby. We've got to have you back. What an honor. What an honor to have you in my life. I'm so privileged to know you. You offer so much every time you come on the show. It's called The Edge Radio Show. We'll see you next Tuesday with another great guest. Bill Frank has been our guest today for a whole hour. Billy the Brain, thank you so much. Patty, can't thank you enough for producing the show. Everybody, stay safe, stay cool, and I'll see you in a couple of days. That's The Coach on KHTS, award-winning KHTS, on The Edge Radio Show. All right.